So, we are studying John's Gospel here, and we're in chapter 15, so if anybody wants to turn there, you can do that along with us. It's so much fun watching the kids. Let me pray real quick, okay? Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to study your word together. We ask that our hearts would be humbled before the scriptures, Father, and that you would teach us what you want us to learn. It's so important that we build our lives on the words of Christ and mediated to us through the Holy Spirit, Father. In Christ's name we pray, amen. So our text today contains one of Jesus' most famous analogies, word pictures, if you will, one of the most well-known. He's the master illustrator, right? He knows how to make a point through illustrations, simple to understand and pretty deep. This one doesn't contain a lot of Jesus' word illustrations, sort of have one idea behind them. This one has more than one idea behind it, okay? It's not one simple, single idea. Like when Jesus pointed to the lilies of the field, do you remember that in the Sermon on the Mount? And he said, consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. But I tell you, not even Solomon in all of his glory clothed himself like one of these. But if God so clothed the grass in the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the furnace, how much more will he clothe you, ye of little faith? I mean, there's one idea. God can create this incredible beauty throughout nature, and he'll take care of you too, right? He'll provide what you need. That's a very simple, beautiful word picture, powerful, memorable. People have remembered it forever. That's one of the few things everybody remembers about the Bible. One idea. But here in John 15, we have an illustration with more complexity, more layers to it, but it's not difficult to understand. It's very simple. So it's one thing with many parts, and they all relate to this particular spiritual lesson that he wants us to give. And it's famous because it's simple, but it answers a lot of questions too, especially about the nature of saving faith and what faith actually looks like. What we called recently up here an obedient faith, right? That's a key element of what faith is. So the illustration itself is something every Israelite and probably a few Californians would know really well, or they could relate to, and that's the vineyard, the idea. A lot of Israel's economy was built on the vineyard, and California's is too, if they don't destroy it. But we have a vineyard just down the road, don't we? Down there in Agua Dulce. Yes, we do. Very lovely place. And they used to have Lucy in a barrel down there or something. But in Israel, it was extremely common. So you see the imagery of the vineyard used in the Old and the New Testament, and Jesus is using it here. In this illustration, another thing that's unique about it is Jesus' illustrations often sort of create this picture and then talks about how it applies to him when he's using an illustration about himself, but it's the opposite this time. He starts with himself, and then he's going to go into the deeper elements of it. So, and the reason it's like that is because this is another I am statement. So we've talked about in John's gospel, there are seven I am statements that are famous. Everything in John is sevens, actually, pretty much. But you remember the first six? I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door of the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. And I am the way, the truth, and the life. Those are the first six I am statements. And now finally, we're at the last one. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. So already it's broadened out a little bit in terms of complexity because he's bringing the Father into the picture as well. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. It's the Father's vineyard, and Jesus is the sturdy center of growth or life. So he's the thick vine stalk from which spring smaller branches or stems that need support. So if Jesus is the vine and the Father's the vine dresser, then who are the branches? Well, it becomes really clear as you read on here. The branches are those people who have some association with the vine. In other words, they're attached to the vine. These would be professing believers he's talking about. So the branches are attached to the vine. Some of them are genuine, some of them are not. How do you know that? Because of the way the story continues. Those who follow Christ are genuine, but everybody in the vine profess to be there. So they're all connected to the vine somehow. And as we read, we see that in the seventh I am statement, it's not only about the person of Christ, it's just as much, it's almost more about the branches. He is the true vine, and it's about that. But its focus is primarily on the branches, because there's two different kinds of branches here. In fact, all of the I am statements are about Jesus' qualities, but they also are all about who Jesus is relates to his followers. All of them are like that, if you think about them. I am the bread of life. Well, what does he say right after that? He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst. He who comes, he who believes, that's salvation. And if you do that, you'll never thirst. Why? Because he's the bread of life. So it's to the benefit of all who come to him. That's the idea. They'll never hunger or thirst. In the same context, just a little bit later, Jesus said, the words that I have spoken to you are spirit and are life. So when he says, I'm the bread of life, he doesn't mean bite me. He means, or swallow me. He means take me to yourself, consume me, right? So he's the bread of life. And he says these words are spiritual. Chapter 8, verse 12, I am the light of the world. Okay, that's who he is. He is the light of the world. But it goes on to the benefit of those who follow him, right? He who follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. So Jesus is the light of the world, but he is the light to those who walk in darkness. The I am statement points to him, but also to the benefit of those who follow him. They won't walk in darkness anymore. John chapter 10, verse 7, truly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. And then right after that, verse 9, he says, I am the door. If anyone enters through me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to kill, steal, and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. So there again, you've got the benefit for him being the door. John 10, 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd, what? Lays down his life for the sheep. So we've talked about all those already in John's gospel. John chapter 11, verse 25, I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. That's number 5. And number 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. So the benefit is you can be reconciled to God. You can come to him, have a real relationship with him through Christ because of who he is, what he's done for us. He is the way. So God the Son brings fullness. He brings reconciliation. He brings light. He brings life. Eternal life, reconciliation with God, truly wonderful stuff. I mean, just right down the line. So now, what does the image of the vine and the branches tell us? That's the question for today. It's actually a warning, very much in keeping with the message of chapter 14, verse 15, where Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. John 14, 21, he who has my commandments and keeps them is the one who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and I will disclose myself to him. So he's telling us not to be fools or fooled, but fools are people that fool themselves, usually. We must not be foolish, but this way, fools think that obedience is optional. Fools think obedience to God is no big deal. But Jesus says that's actually the natural fruit of knowing him, of having faith. Faith is an obedient faith. It's a sign of life. That's why it connects to this vineyard idea. You know what the word quick used to mean? I don't hear anybody in normal conversation use it anymore, but quick means alive. In fact, in the old creeds it says, Jesus will come and judge the... See, I was raised a Lutheran, so we said it every Sunday for my whole life. To judge the quick and the dead. And you go... And as I was a little child, I'm thinking, so like people are fast, he's going to like... the quick, you know. But quick means alive, right? So, and people don't use it that way anymore, but that's what the word means. And they still call it that the quick in a if you cut a nail. Right? Yeah, exactly. That's where life is. That's where the blood is. And if you're looking at a branch, you know, we've all been pruning trees recently. So If you break a twig and it's completely dry, there's no life there. It's the quick, there's no quick. But if it's soft a little bit and you break it open and it's green, well, there's life there. That's the quick. That's the idea. It's that way with vineyards as well, with a vine, same kind of thing with a tree branch. It's the same idea there. So a tree is no longer feeding the branch that is dead. It's not receiving any nutrients of any kind, right? All its nutrients are being sent to living branches. And so you can cut off those branches that are completely dry and doesn't hurt the tree at all. He won't miss it. Jesus talks about vines in just the same way. The vine grower, what's a vine grower? We're not talking about just trees in general. We're talking about a guy producing fruit with his vineyard, right? He wants to see grapes growing. He wants to see the vines producing things for him. So fruit comes from quick branches or dead branches. Yeah, there you go. We're all on the same page. Spiritual fruit is obedience to Christ. It's coming to him, loving him, following him, obeying him. That's spiritual fruit. John 14:15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. We just read that one. Jesus says it several times. That's what he's looking for, an obedient faith. I love Jesus, and I will honor him because I love him with the choices that I make. I will be an obedient servant. Now, none of us are perfectly obedient because we all have sin, but that's the heart of what drives us in our relationship with him. It's really that simple. That's fruit. Fruit is having an obedient faith, something that shows forth from our lives in some meaningful way. It demonstrates life. The fruit demonstrates life. You're never going to see fruit on a dead branch that's not quick, ever. It's dead, right? So look carefully at verse 2 now, John 15. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. The vine grower. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it so that it may bear more fruit. So in the picture, the word picture, God is the vine dresser. Jesus is the vine, and the branches are all that profess faith in him. Those that have no fruit, he takes away, cuts off. And we do that with our trees. If it has no life anymore, you cut it off. It's going to get diseased and stuff and spread into the rest of the tree if you don't deal with it. And that was true for growing vines as well. So there, how many kinds of branches are there in verse 2? Kinds of branches? Two kinds. The quick and the dead. That's exactly right. That's exactly right. So both groups claim to be branches, and Jesus is putting people who profess faith in Christ, part of his vine, into these two categories. One kind has no fruit, it's taken away, it's cut off, it's removed, it's spiritually dead. The other kind shows signs of fruitfulness. Oh, there's green there. It's quick. There's some green there. I'm not going to take that away. I'm going to, as the vine grower, I'm going to prune it. I'm going to cut it back. So I can grow even more. I'm going to trim it up. So the vine grower cuts off useless things, but he keeps the living stem because that can bear fruit. So the vine grower acts to make the living branch more fruitful. That's his goal. That's his purpose for cutting back. And with vines, growing grapes, go down to the vineyard people and ask them. You've got to cut stuff way back. Even if it's quick, you don't just kind of let it grow. Oh, that's a healthy one. I won't touch that. No, you got to cut them way back because then when it grows back, it's even more fruitful. So that's the image Jesus is doing. And your average Jew would know all about this. They'd be very aware of this kind of a situation back in the first century. I should mention that the Greek word for prunes here is actually the word that's usually translated cleanse or clean. Katharos is the Greek word. Did that enter our English language in any way? Yeah, cathartic, a catharsis. I went through this whole catharsis, I'm clean. You know, with that kind of an idea, this cleansing idea, that's all there. So this pruning or cleansing is a major feature of growing vines for the purpose of getting a harvest, a good harvest, the best harvest. So pruning is essential, and that involves these two things: clearing away the dead wood, and pruning, like I said, is not a snip here and a little snip there and cutting back. It's drastically cutting back the living branch so it can be even more fruitful. What is alive has to be pruned heavily, or the growing wood of the vine ends up becoming the dominant. You don't want the wood to become the dominant thing because it doesn't produce anything. You want the branches to be the dominant thing. So even the wood is cut way back. So these things will grow more and produce more fruit. That's the idea. So the dead is removed, the living is cut back, and here's the message. Ready? Are you ready for the message? Mm-hmm. Okay. This is why Jesus is telling this parable or image, this story. God prunes his saints. God prunes his people. If you are a Christian, he's going to prune you. If you're not a Christian, he's going to take you away. But if you're a believer and that new birth has happened within you because you've put your faith in Christ and you do trust him, he's going to prune you. That's the message here. Pruning is good for us. The pruner never cuts the living branch from the vine. He prunes it, but he doesn't cut it. So you're safe, but he's got a purpose for cutting it, and is that to make it more fruitful, like we said. So Christ is the true vine, and as long as we're attached by faith and love toward him, drawing spiritual life from him, the pruning will benefit us to bring forth fruit. That's the whole purpose there. So we are to bear fruit for Jesus. His life is to be seen in us. God cares about our fruit, so he will do the pruning. So in verse 2, God's attention is to the ones who will bear fruit. That's where his focus is. He prunes them so they'll bear more. By the time you get to verse 5, more fruit becomes much fruit. So in verse 2, he's pruning to get more fruit. By the time you get to verse 5, it's much fruit that he's after. So growth, getting better, being more faithful, learning the ropes of walking with Christ, being a faithful Christian, growing in your faith, letting the word of Christ richly dwell within you, as the Apostle Paul would say, we're to bear fruit for Jesus. So God wants to see more fruit, and then he wants to see much fruit, so even more fruit, like any vineyard owner would. God has got that as his plan. So the big question is, what exactly does spiritual pruning mean? Because obviously we're not talking about chopping our arms off, right? So at least I hope not. What is spiritual pruning? What is that? What is God doing when he's pruning us? How does that actually work? Well, it involves us learning to accept God's direction and correction. Okay? God is pointing us in a direction through the Word of God. This is what you're supposed to be like. This is how you're supposed to live. And you go that way. You choose to implement those things in your life. You humble yourself. You repent of anything that's sinful. And you move forward in righteousness and holiness and truth and love and hope and faith and all of those great things, all the Christian virtues. And correction, you stop doing those things you shouldn't be doing, right? So we hear what the Lord Jesus wants from us, and we do it humbly. We take out all that is unproductive and unchristlike from our lives, our attitudes, our demeanor, our thoughts, our actions. We let the Lord evaluate all of those things, and we take out what shouldn't be there. He's going to cut it out. The more we cooperate, the less painful the pruning can be, if you cooperate with him. So, you know what they used to call this? Soul work, right? I'm going to work on my soul and deal with the issues I've got to deal with so I can be a better ambassador for Christ, a more fruitful Christian. I can achieve more for him. My life will count for more. If people see me, whether I'm at work or school or anyplace else, they're going to notice some kind of difference, and they're going to be, well, they're either going to be repelled by it because they love sin, or they're going to be attracted to it because it's different. Wonderfully different than the rest of the world. So that's soul work. So sometimes we balk at it. Oh, I don't want to do that kind of work. And if we don't address certain areas, if we refuse to change in certain areas, God whips out his pruning shears. And he may just deal with us. Now, he might do it through simple, normal, what they call the means of grace, you know. You hear a sermon, you read a book, a brother graciously admonishes you, you know. Hey, this is an area you need to be working on. I can see this part of your life. A brother or sister in Christ tells you that. God ordained circumstances. Sometimes things just happen, sometimes big things, sometimes little things, and that it makes you realize that there's, you know what, I'm not really doing all the right things. It just kind of wakes you up to that, right? Consequences for sin are another part of this. They might fall heavily on us. Sometimes we are afflicted, and it's not necessarily a direct result of this specific thing we've done. It's just that we need to be pruned and learn to get closer to God and appreciate him more and trust him more, not be quite so arrogant and neglectful and all this. God has a million ways to get us to stop and reflect. One way is bopping us on the head, but there's other ways, you know, to get our attention. There's a famous British poet, Francis Bourdillon, who wrote about God's grace in pruning, and it's so good I want to read you just a little piece of it. He said, "Cannot every Christian who has been under God's pruning knife bear witness to the gentle firmness with which it has been used?" I can bear witness to that. "There is no weakness or wavering in God's dealings, yet no roughness. There's no lack of decision, no half work, no rashness, no mistake. The gardener's hand may make a slip. He may cut too deep or cut when he did not mean to cut. Not so at the hand of God. When he takes the knife, he uses it with perfect firmness, with unerring wisdom, with tender and compassionate love. He makes no slip. He will not cut too deep. He will give no needless pain. He will take away no comfort that would have been better left. Do not shrink from your Father's hand, even though the knife is in it. Trust him. Love him. He will do all wisely, tenderly, faithfully. Let it be your heart's desire to abide more closely to Christ and to bring forth more fruit to the glory of God." I just think that's really deserving contemplation. There's a great truth there. God always seeks the best for his children. Always. And you've got to trust that. He always seeks that. So nothing he's going to do is going to be against you. It's for you to be a better person, to be Christ-like, to be moving towards fruitfulness. He's a perfect father, and he doesn't punish us just to punish us. He never loses his cork. It's purposeful and beneficial, usually just involving us learning to trust him, and of course getting our attention to make course corrections where we need to make course corrections when we're off on the wrong path. Always be thankful for pruning. I guess that's the thing. You know, Paul says be thankful in all things. Pruning is something to be thankful for. Yeah, but it hurts. Oh, she's cutting. No, it's all right. It's all right. It's for your good, always for your good, to bring forth good fruit, which has a great reward. Producing fruit is rewarded by God. And don't be too surprised by it. You got to expect to be pruned now and then. So the true followers of Jesus need pruning. And that tells us that we're not perfect. Did you know? Did you know you're not perfect? We're far from it. We won't be perfect until we leave off this mortal life. So he wants us to be teachable, and if we need to be pruned to be more teachable, he'll do that. We need to repent, he'll take care of that, to draw our attention to the need for repentance. If we need to draw closer to the Lord than we have been, he'll use that. He'll prune us to draw our attention to the fact that we need to be closer to the Lord. Pruning can be painful. The Lord might take something away that's important to us, part of our identity, the life we wanted, the life we worked for and fought for. He might take some of those things away, the things that we love. If he does that, he actually wants something better for you. Well, I don't get it. I don't see it. Start looking for it. Look for it with him. He wanted you to become fruitful in what matters. So that's good. So let him have whatever he wants to take away. Now, verse 3 is really interesting. This is not a new teaching. He says, you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Now, remember, the word prune is what? Clean. That's what it means, to cleanse. So it's the same word. And that's the only two uses of the word clean in the John's gospel are here. So verse 3 and verse 1. So you are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. How do they need cleaning? And now he tells them they're already clean. How does that work? It's exactly what we saw in the upper room discourse at the very beginning of that when Jesus washed the disciples' feet. Do you remember? Peter did not want Jesus to wash his feet. He thought he was honoring Jesus by saying, no, no, you shall never wash my feet. Remember that? He was telling Jesus what to do. Don't do that. John 13:8, Peter said to him, never shall you wash my feet. Jesus said, if I don't wash you, you have no part with me. And what did Peter do? Lord, wash not only my feet, but also my hands and my head. So it's always extremes with Peter, right? So then Jesus says, and this is the key point here, he who has bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you. That was a side glance to Judas sitting across the table. So Judas was not clean, but the rest of them were clean. They were already clean. They bathed. What does that mean? We're not talking about water here. They had come to Christ. They were already forgiven in him. The cross, even though he hadn't gone to it yet, but I mean, that applies across the board in history. So they were already saved. That's what that means. They were already justified by Christ. You will recall that being already clean is talking about justification, being righteous in the eyes of God, saved. So Peter's clean, but then Jesus says you have to wash your feet. So there needs to be a daily ongoing cleansing. Why? Because we're still sinners, right? We still blow it sometimes. So there has to be this ongoing cleansing. So Peter finally starts to pick up on that message. But the cleansing of God's pruning is essential for us to be the kind of follower of Jesus that he wants us to be. Yeah, we do our best, but you know, you should spend some time asking God what he wants you to do and how he wants to direct you. That's part of what we're talking about here with this whole thing. Pruning doesn't save, because we're already a living branch if we're going to be pruned. So this is something God's doing to save people. Saved people do need correction and refinement in our walk. So God graciously prunes us. Okay, all of that said, let's go to verse 4. I think that's the main point here, verse 4. And it's a command. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. So he's talking about fruit. That's the key thing. Where's that fruit going to come from? From abiding in him. So abide is the word. You cannot be fruitful unless you abide. So as soon as a branch is detached, it stops being, it'll never have fruit, ever, right? The idea of producing fruit is over, done. But a believer is not a detached vine. He or she is a pruned vine, right? So God's going to do that work. He's going to keep that work going. And that harkens back to 14:17, where Jesus said the Spirit will be with you and he will be in you. He'll always be there. Abide with him. Abide with Christ. Abide is the key word here. And the word abide, so what does that mean? It means remain. That's one thing that it means. Sometimes it's translated that way. You know, if you look at all the different translations, most translations would say abide, but several have remain, because that is what the word means. Remain, stay with. Stay with is the idea behind that. Dwell with is another way it's used, to dwell with somebody, to be together, to live together, that sort of idea there. So it means that Jesus is our companion every day. To abide with Christ is to have him close to you every day. And we relate to him every day. It's pretty easy, even for a Christian, to kind of go through life and get caught up in everything and not spend any time with Jesus. You're living together and you never talk. You don't spend time with him, you ignore him. And then you come to church on Sunday, you get reminded, oh yeah, I'm supposed to spend time with Jesus. I'll spend time in church. Well, that's great, but that's not what he wants. He doesn't want it to be limited to that. Abide in me and I in you. It's a relationship. There's a spiritual bond that comes with the new birth, a bond that cannot be broken. But by neglect, we can weaken the influence of the spiritual bond we have with Christ. We can minimize its effectiveness in transforming us and helping us to produce fruit. Two people can live in the same house and one of them can ignore the other person all the time, right? That's not the way you want to have a relationship with Jesus. Our relationship with God is to be continuously open-hearted. And the Bible, the New Testament, uses this idea of walking. Actually, the Old does too. We'll talk about that in a minute. It's our duty to be always aware of God's presence. It's hard to do that all the time because we get distracted. But that's our goal. That's our duty. And we should welcome God's presence. And the love that saved us in Christ is the same love that is seeking our best. And our best is always found in a right relationship with him. So that's what's going on. That's what should be going on. So we don't walk with God. Walking with God is not him standing over us with a scowl on his face, just waiting to take care of us. Oh, you're going to blow it, I can tell. That's not what that relationship is like. God wants to produce the best things in you. He wants what's best for you. Not giving you everything you want, but achieving everything he wants to achieve in your life. That's how it works. He actually walks with you and overlooks all of your missteps, or many of them, right? Oh, boy, they did it again. Oh. His strong desire is to bring forth fruit, not to smack you up every time you tremble or misstep or make a mistake or something. So, believe means to abide and to be connected at the deepest level with the heart of Christ. That's what that means. So verse 5, let's go to that. We're going to end with verse 5. This defines what that relationship of abiding looks like. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For, here's a really important line here, apart from me, you can do nothing. So here's where the branches are clearly identified as the disciples of Jesus. And the wonderful truth here is the amazing possibility that we simple mortals, sinful as we are, can bear much fruit for God. So it was fruit, more fruit, and now we're talking about much fruit. So it's a great truth that this amazing things can follow if we're consistently walking with God on a regular basis. And I think walking is the best synonym for this abiding idea in the Bible. There's two senses there. The New Testament uses walking quite a bit and the Old as well. But abiding and walking, they kind of have a different flavor. So abiding is sort of the relationship itself, this remaining with him, so it's a constant interaction between ourselves and God. Let me read you what the NIV translates verse 4, because it uses that word remain. Remain in me, and I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. So abide, remain, they mean a very similar thing, but they don't really suggest a particular action. It's more of a state of being or a relationship that's close and steady. I guess that's the idea of abide. Close and steady relationship. Like living in the same house. Only this abiding is based on a true joining, a spiritual joining of God the Holy Spirit with our spirit. And Christ dwelling in us through the Spirit. That's the idea there. So we are in Christ. He is in us. Not as a status, but as an actual union together. But if we add to abide the idea of walking, then we have this active element in the relationship. So we are consciously walking with him. And that's where it comes in, I think, to help us feel through how to do this kind of a thing. He's always and everywhere with us. He's always and everywhere in us, if we're a believer. And we can communicate with him at any time. But do we? How often do we do it? You can thank him at any time. You can pray for other people at any time. You can worship Christ at any time. Nothing's stopping you. Except you, right? So if we add to abide this idea of walking, I think we start to pick up on it. Walking with God, walking before God is the way the Bible says it sometimes. That is the active element in the relationship. Every step I take is with God, every step. Not this step I take and then next week I'm going to take another step with him. The idea of walking is every step, right? Not days going by without thinking about God or relating to God, letting the world take over our thoughts and mind. The Old Testament uses that language about certain individuals, which is really interesting. Only a few people in the Old Testament are just said to walk with God. That doesn't mean more people didn't do it, but it only mentions a few. So very, very, very early in human history, you have Enoch, who's the father of Methuselah. Methuselah lived really long. Enoch never died. He's the only person in the Old Testament that didn't die. And he was just a puppy. He was 365 years old. It says he walked with God. That's Genesis chapter 5, verse 24. He walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Now, there's a lot about Enoch. I don't want to get into all that right now. Just so you know, he walked with God. He was a very God-centered person. Every day, every step of every day, he's thinking about God. He's relating to God. He's including God in his life. And so God just takes him. He's probably going to come back someday, but that's a big question. The next person it talks about like that is Noah. Genesis 6, 9. Noah was a righteous man, blameless in his time. Noah walked with God. That's how it describes him. Blameless in his time. Maybe the most surprising example in the Old Testament is David. The Lord told Solomon in 2 Chronicles 7, 17, if you walk before me as your father David walked, even to do according to all that I have commanded you, and will keep my statutes and my ordinances, then I will establish your royal throne as I covenanted with your father David. Now, as you know, David was kind of a sinner sometimes, like a big one, sometimes. Not always wise, but in one thing he was supremely faithful. And at the time, that was a very big thing. David was no idolater. When Israel was idolatrous, over and over and here and yon and this god and that goddess and all this kind of stuff, David was faithful to the Lord in that sense. He was not only an idolater, he was a worshiper. And, you know, he wrote half the Psalms, and you can follow his life in those Psalms. And when he sinned, and he sinned big sometimes, those Psalms have Psalms of true repentance in them. Psalm 51, Psalm 32. David was a sincere lover of God. He was just kind of a dope sometimes. In the New Testament letters, the apostles almost never use the language of abide, except John, as much as they do walk. They love that phrase, walking. Step-by-step relationship with God. Colossians 2:6 is one example. Therefore, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him. It's the same idea as abide. It's just giving you sort of a stronger way to think about it in terms of action. Walk suggests moment by moment, step by step. That is what abiding is. To have fruit, we have to keep as close to Christ in our thinking, in our hearts, and in our giving attention to as we can. And not let those things go. We have a world that's very, very busy. And there are so many distractions. Some of you are wearing them on your hip, or they're in your purse. That big distraction thing. I think that was invented by dark forces down below. It's got a certain convenience, but it sure is addicting, and it's meant to be addicting. That's the whole purpose of it, to make money off of you and to distract you from things you should be thinking about it. I leave mine in another room sometimes, and people get mad because I don't answer it, but Actually, I was going to say there's a noble reason for me doing that, but actually I just forget I've left it in. But that's the truth. But you have to stay close to Christ. Let's go back to verse 5 real quick in this quick summary statement. Apart from me, you can do nothing. So we'll wrap up with this. Jesus doesn't mean when he says you can do nothing apart from me that you can't go to a Dodger game without him, or you can't go shopping without him, or earn some money without him. Now, in a big sense, that's true. I mean, you can't breathe without God sustaining your life, but that's not what he's talking about here. Jesus is saying we can accomplish nothing of lasting value, true change, God-given fruit. We can't do that apart from abiding in him. And when you see religions and churches and religious leaders do that without him, it becomes really obvious pretty soon. It becomes about money. It becomes about fame. It becomes about prestige. It becomes about power. And that's where a lot of bad things happen in religious circles. Jesus is saying, you can't do it apart from me. You can't do my work apart from me. You've got to abide. You've got to walk. You've got to be with me. You've got to let me speak to you, and you've got to come to me with your life and your issues and let me deal with them according to the word. So let me sum up. We exist for God. We're saved for a purpose, and our purpose is his glory. And there are many, many ways we can be involved in producing fruit for him, that we can do that. One way we just experienced all week long, I'm worn out with it, but and that's just ministering to children in our community. That's just one way that you can manifest fruit for God, right? Lots of volunteers made VBS happen, young people and very old people. The Bible's great story was shared every single day during that week, and connections were made with people, and all kinds of great conversations happened. And naturally, some of us couldn't be there. We had to go to work or do this or that, right? But if you prayed for that, if you prayed for the event, if you prayed for the children that came, then you, by the Holy Spirit, because he's in the people that were here and he's in you and you're abiding with Christ, he takes your prayers and he answers your prayers for people that are doing this work here this week that had the time or were available to do it. And you are fully participating in that and creating fruit by praying for it. You were a true participant if you did that, because the same Lord dwells in each of us and we're his body on the earth. That's how it happens. When you pray for a missionary, you're actually participating in what they're doing somewhere. You actually are. You think, well, let's pray for the missionary. No, let's pray for the missionary. We just talked about this pastor in India. He got mercilessly beaten. And I saw the picture of him. It's tragic, just horrible. People are being burned alive. Villages are being destroyed. Things happen all over the world. Pray for those people. Put the device away for a little while and pray for those people. You can think of things to pray for a guy who just got beat up. His family, his little church family, his future ministry, his need for courage and faithfulness. Good grace with the government, perhaps? The Bible's great story was shared every day here, but it's many other places it can be shared, many other times in life when it can be shared. When you work somewhere, start praying for the people around you. Pray for that opportunity. You know, when I was working in Hollywood, there was like, it was all a bunch of young people working in this crazy environment. And if you're a pretty steady person with some kind of level of fruit, and I had a little bit back then when I was young, but they kind of come to you when things really go south for them. It's like suddenly you're the steady person. They might have made fun of you before that, but then they've got some big need and then they come to you, right? And then you can build that relationship and you can share the gospel. You just to pray for those people to have those open doors. If you don't pray for an open door, you're probably not going to get one. But if you pray for one, God might just do that. Much fruit, you and the Holy Spirit, you and Christ working together. If you abide, then you're communicating with the always present Lord on behalf of the gospel. on behalf of other people in ministry, other people doing ministry. That's how fruit becomes much fruit. It becomes more fruit and much fruit. So what you do as you abide in Christ, the true vine, matters. It really matters very, very much. Lord willing, we're going to pick it up here next week, and let's pray. Our great Father, we are your people, and we love you, and we invite you to bring the pruning shears into our lives. Cut freely, trim, cut away encumbrances, cut away sins, cut away habits that limit our fruitfulness. Remind us to pray, to care, to reach out, to encourage each other. Use us, Father, for the glory of Christ and the gospel. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.